inflation, widespread poverty, political meltdown. These are just some of the problems facing the people of Zimbabwe. The Catholic Church is doing its utmost to bring hope to a desperate situation. But where does the focus of her efforts lie, and what are the roots of the Church in this land?
The political situation in Zimbabwe for Catholics is a bit challenging, in the sense that we have our Catholic faithful involved very strongly in politics. They are all coming to church, but they are not belonging to the same parties. The same people whom we are preaching to sometimes, when they now go outside there, they tend to turn against each other.
I would say right from the 1980s, when we thought we had got independence and the democratic system was promising. But really, if you look at the way how the elections were held just from there, were held from there, it was all, a lot of violence was involved. And that fear was really instilled in the larger population.
So that trauma is still there. That fear is still there. But we cannot live with that fear forever and ever. We need to move on. We need to build, we need to change.
We are trying to conscientize our Catholics that we become mature. That politics is not meant for you to shed blood.
I don't know, we would like to see that they say, a real, clear harmony among the people. No matter which party or which opinion do I have, right? But to live in this multi-party society where real and true democracy can prevail.
Children are brought up with differences. Some are already angry with each other because they simply belong to different parties and to different families. And as a church, we cannot watch this and keep quiet. We need to reach out to help reconcile the children so that their influence can also go to the parents. And I see education as one of the only powerful tools still at our disposal. We have been approached as a church if we could establish a school. These premises we are in have been granted to the Catholic Church, and this building is meant for a church. The community comes to pray here on Sundays. During the week, the children are learning here, and on Sundays we come to worship. We hope by God's grace that we will be able to build a school where the children will be able to learn well. When children get sick, they are sent to nearby hospitals where there's generally not enough medicine. And because of that, they are given prescriptions, asked to go and buy the medicine, and most of them cannot afford it. So the children sometimes just come to school sick because they can't afford the medicine. I'm reminded of that because of this young child I'm seeing here. They stand on the bench there. This is rash. It can be treated, but unfortunately, probably there is no money to buy the medicine. It just comes to school. Our real concern is if it spreads to other children, then a school won't be that good a place to send children to. So we are very much concerned, but we are happy that they are contented themselves. Thank you. Good morning.
Follow. I clap.
Illness is in the schools. We have some really identified cases of
children with AIDS. Now they are asked to go to get medicine from time to time, particularly in the rural areas. And the cost of transport from their place to their big hospitals is very, very expensive. You always watch it with tears dropping because you can't do much, you can't help everybody. And yet the desire is there.
I think children of Zimbabwe loves to go to school because they know that education is the key to success. If there is no education, there is no life. But we can see that we do not have enough resources at schools.
No exercise books, no adequate resources for their family members to support them. So it's so difficult for us to go to school.
When we opened school this term, one school had only two teachers out of 15. Another school had three, also out of 15. And a third school had only one teacher out of 12.
The major challenges that we are facing presently is that of teachers who are disgruntled about the salaries that they are getting. It is far below the poverty datum line.
Oh, our basic needs is we don't have. Those teachers who are smiling outside, it's just because Zimbabweans are good at smiling, but truly speaking, we are in trouble.
So we find that at times, people will not come to work. Not because they don't want to, but because they do not have the money.
Our parents are putting effort to send us to school, but some of the teachers may not come. Yet we spend the whole day sitting. We find it difficult to read on our own without teachers.
The food situation is also affecting us, and affecting very much. We don't have access to the staple food as we had. Our people do not have access to it as in the past. It's scarce, at times it's not available at all. We see people suffering of hunger.
The children are coming hungry to school, and they go back hungry unless they get some supplementary feeding at school.
I'm currently searching for something which is good for me, which is food, and other resources for learning, like books, something like that.
The first meal they will have is lunch, which is provided at school. The whole morning they are trying to learn on hungry stomachs.
I'm the example of someone who's suffering from hunger. So I walk at least 7 kilometers. By the time I approach this school, I felt very exhausted. So it becomes a challenge to me to learn very well.
There's been an exodus of teachers going for greener pastures outside the country. The fees are too high for the people. So most of the children are going to school to go and while up time. They are not teachers.
We have lost many professionals, like qualified teachers, experienced teachers. They are going to neighboring countries.
Zimbabweans want to be in Zimbabwe. They don't want to be in South Africa. But they are faced with a situation where Zimbabwe, which is their mother country, is not life-giving anymore. They just simply can't live. They don't have food. They can't just go out and buy a bottle of milk or a loaf of bread.
Inflation is at an we can't talk about the figure because it is always skyrocketing each and every day. And we are likely going to face a problem of unemployment, food shortage, and our families are expecting much from us, but this is not going to be, because we are going empty-handed like this, you know. Everything was looted. It's a very big problem to us, and we are very angry about this situation.
South Africans are not welcoming of Zimbabweans, not all the time. There are people who understand and would take people in, give them food, give them clothes and so on. But generally, people are becoming very xenophobic.
They are actually accusing us for taking away their jobs, and they are also accusing us for taking away their women. They are also accusing us for all sorts of things, of which that is not the case. We are self-employed to do our own things, and we are thinking that this is a good haven for us, Zimbabweans, since our country is facing a lot of problems economically and politically. That is the reason we are here.
When they get to the, before they get to the border, they have to cross the Limpopo River, which, if the rains have been very good, it's a very big river with a very strong current. People get swept away. There's crocodiles in the rivers. They get eaten by the crocodiles. And when they cross illegally through the border, they're crossing over or under barbed wire. So some of them get electrocuted. And then they have to walk through the local farms in Mersina, where some of them are mauled by wild animals such as lions and so on. So it's quite a great deal of things that they have to deal with before they even get to South Africa. And when they arrive, they still have more to deal with: the xenophobia, being arrested, being taken back, and having to walk over again through the same things as they did before.
Given our economic situation, we often find ourselves in a situation where the local church cannot support itself. And that's mainly because the laity, the faithful themselves, find themselves in a situation where they cannot support themselves given the rate of inflation within the country. And so really we are very grateful to international benefactors who have actually stepped in, you know, over the years and supported the local church in different ways. Without that support, I don't think the church would have been able to sustain itself, you know, to the present.
I would expect from the Christians certainly a prayer. I think it is God, he's the only one who can touch our hearts and can change our minds and can make us come to our senses. I am convinced that is a major point, the major help that I would ask for.